Okay. So thank you everybody for joining our SAP BTP Garage for September. We're really excited about today's session. Of course, AI is a hot topic, has been for a while, will continue to be for the foreseeable future. We're going to be talking about Joule, and of course I have invited on another expert to join us today, Harjeet Judge. For the session, we are going to be providing a recording that will be available on YouTube. It usually takes us a couple of days to get that uploaded, but it's always available on our SAP community brand channel. I will provide a link to that at the end of the call. We had the session earlier this morning. So in today's call, we had Alan this morning who already presented it for her APJ audience, did an excellent job. And again, we'll have another one now with Harjeet Judge. So Harjeet Judge has been with SAP for over 20 years. So he's very experienced, coming from various different topics. Now he's an SAP BTP, but he was in SAP Analytics Cloud. He worked a little bit with SAP Business Objects. Strong background in security, so definitely an expert in several areas, with us for quite a long time. So I thank you so much, Harjeet, for joining us today. For the topic, we're going to be covering our SAP Discovery Center mission, which has the title Activate Joule for SAP SuccessFactors. So for our newcomers, if you're just joining the garage for the first time today, in every one of our garage sessions, we focus on one SAP Discovery Center mission. The reason for that is to bring you and enable you on the latest SAP business technology platform use cases. So the different BTP services that you can leverage to solve various business solutions or business challenges that you might have with BTP solutions. So for this specific example, we're going to be talking about Joule. You'll learn about exactly what Joule is, how you can activate it, and also see a little bit of a demo on how exactly it operates as a chatbot or a chat assistant. So without further ado, I will hand over to Harjeet if you want to give a little bit of more of a background or an introduction on yourself. And then without that, just go ahead and jump right into your topic. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Cecilia. Hi, everyone. Good morning. Good afternoon. So as Cecilia mentioned, the mission that I created on the Discovery Center, it provides a guided hands-on for customers to follow and set up Joule within their SuccessFactor environment. But before we start getting into the steps and the process that's mentioned in the mission to get this activation working, I thought it'd be a good idea to just have a quick overview of what Joule is and how it kind of fits into the overall SAP picture here. So I'm going to be sharing a slide here. So just bear with me and let me know if this is visible to you.
Not yet.
Am I listed as a presenter in the Teams? My share icon is blocked off. Yeah.
Let me double check. There you go.
All right, perfect. So I will just have one slide that I wanted to bring up. So let me know if everyone can see it. I don't necessarily need to even go into presenter mode here because I just wanted to highlight.
We can see it now.
You can see the slide or no?
Yep. Yep.
All right. It went blank on my side, unfortunately. Just give me a second.
Yeah, we see the deck. Not there we go. Now we see the actual slide.
All right, perfect. So I have quite a few slides in this deck, and I'm not going to present every single one. So the one that's probably the most relevant is the very first one, which kind of talks about the different AI capabilities from SAP and how Joule fits into that overall picture. And so at the bottom here, you have the various different hyperscalers and, you know, the large language model providers that SAP partners up with. And so we work with those large language model providers, whether it's, you know, ChatGPT or some other ones. On top of that, we have our AI foundation, which is within the BTP environment. So when we're building any kind of generative AI capabilities in our products, we're leveraging this AI foundation layer that works with these different providers underneath it to offer those AI capabilities in the SAP portfolio. So a lot of the different SAP applications, whether it's SuccessFactors or some of the cloud ERP systems and so on, we will have Gen AI capabilities in those products if they are not already in place. At the moment, SuccessFactors is probably the most advanced, right? Where we have Gen AI capabilities in SuccessFactors. For example, if I want to generate a job description in SuccessFactors, I can use a Gen AI capability to automatically generate a job description in the SuccessFactor interface. Similarly, we're adding those capabilities, those Gen AI capabilities in the various different SAP applications, right? Whether that's the ERP system, the Ariba system, and so on. Joule is something that sits on top of these capabilities, if you will. Right. And Joule is an application or a digital assistant that pops up in the different LOB solutions so that you can then interact with different types of use cases or transactional use cases within that application. So if I'm in SuccessFactors, there is an icon that pops up. Change my address, for example, in SuccessFactors, I would be able to do that directly from within the Joule environment. I don't actually have to navigate anywhere else in the application to be able to do that. In addition, there are also what we call navigational use cases in Joule that we also support. Those navigational use cases will allow me to get access to a particular application in that environment relatively quickly, rather than me having to navigate, for example, to book time off. I can just go into Joule and say, okay, I need to book some time off. What do I need to do? It will give me a link to the time off application in SuccessFactor, and I can go in and do that work without having to navigate to different menu options in the application. So there are both transactional use cases as well as navigational use cases that are supported, at least at the moment, with SuccessFactor that you can use. So that's it for the slide deck. I didn't want to go into too much detail on this part because the focus for this is to look at the Discovery Center mission on how to activate Joule in SuccessFactors. Okay. So if I look at the architecture diagram here for Joule integration with SuccessFactors, you can see that the different components that are involved. So you have your SuccessFactor environment on the left hand side. So after Joule is set up, it will be basically a plugin directly in SuccessFactor that you can launch from the SuccessFactor interface, right? So that the user experience would be that they log into SuccessFactor, they click on the Joule icon, and then the Joule instance or the chatbot will launch from within that application. Right, so the SuccessFactor is where Joule would be hosted, but in order for that chatbot, if you will, or for Joule to work within that SuccessFactor environment, there are lots of other components that come into the picture. Right, so you have your BTP subaccount on the right-hand side as well, and this is where the Joule instance actually sits. So when you launch the chatbot in SuccessFactors, the Joule service is actually hosted inside a BTP subaccount. Okay, and it leverages the destinations in BTP as well as the connectivity service in BTP to be able to offer those navigational as well as those transactional use cases that I just talked about. Okay. In particular, we also have we also create as part of the setup process an instance of build work zone, and we do a user sync from SuccessFactor to build work zone using the identity provisioning service as well. And this is what that when we do that user sync from SuccessFactor into build work zone, it's that sync that offers the navigational use cases that I just talked about earlier in Joule. Okay? So there are lots of different architectural components that come into the picture to set up Joule properly. You need your BTP subaccount, you need the Joule service inside that BTP subaccount, you need this build work zone instance to support the navigational use cases. Then you also need cloud identity services for authentication, right? So when you launch Joule, it's authenticating with an IaaS tenant. And we also need the identity provisioning service, which is used then, as I mentioned before, for the replication from SuccessFactor into this build work zone environment to support the navigational use cases. So there's lots of these components that are going to come into the setup process. So the setup is somewhat complex. It does require multiple user personas to be available to do this properly. So you will need a BTP Global Account Admin, because the BTP Global Account Admin would be the one that would go in and create the sub accounts, ensure that we have the right entitlements added to the sub account, and also run the booster on the BTP Global Account side to set up Joule properly. We also need the Cloud Identity Services Admin, because there will be some configuration that you would do in identity authentication as well as identity provisioning. And then there's a whole set of configuration that you do on the SuccessFactor side to give people access to Joule and ensure that they have proper permissions to execute those use cases, whether those are transactional use cases or navigational use cases on the SuccessFactor side. So that's why in order to set this up properly, we need all of these different user personas available to us to do this. Yeah. So when you're going through the mission later on, you will need to work with your colleagues from the organization that have the access to those respective systems to be able to set this up properly in your landscape. So on the mission, I give you a bit of an overview of what Joule is, and I have this architecture diagram as well that you can share with your colleagues just to get an idea of what the Joule architecture looks like. But the most important part is obviously the project board. And on the project board is where we talk about the different steps that you need to go through to set this up in your environment, with your SuccessFactor environment. So in the discover phase, I have a solution overview. And in the solution overview, we talk about some of the resources that you have that you can also leverage to get more get additional insight to Joule. Let me wait for this to come up here. And so there are links here on some of the demo videos that you can watch. I also have the architecture highlighted here, but I wanted to just click on this link that talks about the different use cases that are supported for Joule in SuccessFactors, right? And I talked about that the transactional use cases, and you can see a list of those transactional use cases mentioned here. There are also navigational use cases, and this is where I talked about the user replication from SuccessFactor to work zone is important in order to be able to support these navigational use cases. So going back to the transactional use cases, you can see there's quite a wide list of different use cases, but many of them are Employee Central specific, right? So Employee Central is a module in SuccessFactors. And in order to realize or use these use cases, there are certain things that you have to do on the SuccessFactor side, including setting up these Employee Central quick actions on SuccessFactor. So as long as you have these quick actions enabled on SuccessFactor with proper permissions, then this particular use case, for example, in Joule will also work as well. Okay, so there are set of configuration that you need to enable on the SuccessFactor side to make this work properly. Yeah. So only the use cases that you see listed here, the transactional as well as the navigational use cases, those are the only ones that are currently supported in Joule. So if you go into Joule and ask it something completely random, that is not one of the use cases that's supported. It's not going to be able to respond to that query in the interface. Okay. All right, so that's the different use cases and just a bit of an introduction on what this solution overview page tile contains, right? So it's got some link to other videos, other resources that you can use to read up on. And it also has a link to this data center mapping option. So at the moment, your Joule instance that you are setting up for SuccessFactor needs to run in particular data centers or in your BTP environment. And there's a mapping between SuccessFactors and the Joule instance in the BTP subaccount. So for example, if my SuccessFactor tenant is running in this particular data center, if I want to set up Joule successfully, I would need my BTP subaccount created in this particular data center in this particular hyperscaler. So there is this mapping that's there at the moment. I know we're planning to get rid of this data center mapping specifically so we can have our Joule subaccount in different data centers. It doesn't have to be corresponding to the data center that's in SuccessFactors, but we're not quite there yet. So for the time being, you do need to pay attention to this. So if, when you're creating your BTP subaccount in your environment, we want to make sure that it's in the correct data center. So, and it matches with whatever your SuccessFactor instance data center is as well. Okay? So that's the type of information that you'll be able to get from the solution overview tile in this mission. So the other areas that are probably the most important are the preparation area as well as the setup area. And the preparation for activating Joule in SuccessFactor is super important because we need to ensure that we have everything in place in order to go through this particular setup that that I'll show you later on. Yeah. So I have, I think, 13 or 14 different preparation steps, 13 different preparation steps that the SuccessFactor, the BTP admin, as well as the Cloud Identity Services admin need to follow before they can activate Joule. And I'll just go through a couple of these preparation steps so everyone's aware on what are some of the things that you need to think about when you do this activation. So the first one, which is probably the most important one, as I mentioned, is having the right user personas available to you when you do this setup, because you will need to touch multiple components: BTP, SuccessFactor, Cloud Identity Services. So that's one of the hard prerequisites to be able to go through this mission and activate Joule. Yeah. The other one is to ensure that you have the proper licenses for Joule. So you should see certain entitlements in your BTP global account that have the Joule entitlements, as well as the Build Work Zone Foundation or the standard plan available to you in BTP. Okay, so I can quickly show you that. Most of you are pretty familiar with BTP or are likely familiar with BTP, so you know how to check these entitlements. So I'm just going to go into my BTP global account. And what we will see is under the service assignments, I should be able to see the Joule licenses available to me. Yeah. Let me wait for this to come up. So if I just search for Joule. In customer landscapes, the service is called Joule, and you will see this dash application as a service technical name, and the plan type and typically for customers would be the foundation plan, not the standard plan. In my case, this is an internal BTP environment, so the plan type is a little bit different. But for customers, you will see the Joule service. You'll see the foundation plan listed in your entitlements. If you do not see these entitlements available in the BTP global account, that means that you have not gone through the commercial process and worked with your AE to go through the proper paperwork to get the licenses for Joule. And then once that paperwork is done, the Joule entitlements should be visible in the BTP global account. Other scenarios where I've seen customers run into a bit of hiccups when they try to look at these entitlements is sometimes customers have multiple global accounts. So when you're going through the sales process and you do not specify which global account you want the entitlements to be included in, we will actually create a new global account for you and add the Build Work Zone entitlements as well as the Joule entitlements to that global account. So as an admin of an existing global account, you may not even be aware that has happened in the background, and you may not even have access to that global account where these Joule entitlements are visible. Okay. To avoid that, when you're going through the contracting and going through the commercial process with your SAP account executive, make sure you tell them that the entitlement should go to an existing global account that you already use for other purposes. Otherwise, you may end up seeing a new global account, and then you have to go through the whole commercial process again to get the entitlements to show up in the correct global account that you do want to use. Okay, so that's something that we want to avoid you having to go through. But the way you can quickly check if you have the entitlements are by just looking at the Joule service. Similarly, you should have entitlements for build work zone. So if you don't have build work zone already, or if you're just a SuccessFactor customer and you don't even have a BTP environment at all, as part of the Joule license, we will give you access to a BTP global account. And in that BTP global account, you'll have the Joule entitlements, and you will also have the build work zone standard entitlement. And the plan type that you will have access to is the foundation plan, which is what we need in order to set up Joule with SuccessFactors. You can use a standard plan as well if you have it, but the foundation plan will suffice in this case. Okay? So that's one of the different prerequisites that I talked about. So ensuring that the global account has the right entitlements for you to be able to go through this mission and set up Joule. The other one that I'm going to highlight, and that would be it for some of these prerequisites, is the ability to ensure that the SuccessFactor profile has the global user ID field populated in their SuccessFactor profile. Okay? And this should happen already because when SuccessFactor is integrated with IAS, and that is something that should have been done already before you try to set up Joule as part of your previous project. When you do that integration, you also run a provisioning job from SuccessFactor to replicate users into IAS. And as part of that provisioning job, we basically take the global user ID from the IAS user profile, and we write that global user ID back into the SuccessFactor user profile. So the global user ID in SuccessFactor, which is a screenshot on the right-hand side, should match the global user ID that you see in the IAS user profile. If that's not the case, if the global user ID doesn't match, or if it's empty in SuccessFactor, what that means is that the user replication from SuccessFactor to IAS was not done as part of the project that you completed to integrate IAS with SuccessFactor. And so that's the first thing you would need to do, is to run that application job, make sure the user sync is working properly, and this global user ID is populated properly for your user profiles. Okay? And you can check that in SuccessFactors through the Manage Login Accounts app. So I'm just going to go into my SuccessFactor environment, and I'll show you this, how you can validate it. So I'm going into my SuccessFactor instance, and in SuccessFactors, if you go into the Manage Login Accounts app, and I will search for just one user, let's pick one of my SuccessFactor users. This gives me a listing or some information about my user profile, but the field that I'm interested in is the global user ID field, and that you can get by clicking on the setting to make sure that the field is visible in the display. And then this field, this global user ID, should match the global user ID that's in IAS. So let me go open up my IAS tenant as well. And so if I search for that same user in IAS, look for my F. Trombley user, this global user ID right here should match the global ID for the user in SuccessFactor. And like I said, this should happen if you've done the integration with SuccessFactor to IAS properly, which is a prerequisite for you to set up Joule. Yeah? So all of these things that I'm mentioning in the Discovery Center, like these preparation steps, these are super important for you to follow to actually set up Joule properly in the landscape. So there's 13 of these steps that are relevant. The other one that I wanted to just highlight that's important is knowing which domain to use when you're setting up your IaaS trust in your subaccount. So as part of the setup process, we have a BTP subaccount where you will be setting up a trust to an IaaS tenant, and that IaaS tenant would be the same one that's used by SuccessFactors, right? So not only do you need to know which IaaS tenant is used with SuccessFactors, you also then need to know, when I set up the trust, which domain should I use? So there are other prerequisites that help you determine whether you should use the cloud.sap domain to set up the subaccount trust with IaaS, or whether you should use the ondemand.com domain to set up the subaccount trust. This is also super important because if you pick the wrong domain, depending upon how your success factor is integrated with IaaS, when you try to launch Joule, you'll see error messages come up because it can't authenticate properly, right? So, and I have steps in this mission that talk about what you need to do to understand what type of domain should be used when you set up the subaccount trust. So all of these preparations phases, steps are very important in order to actually set up Joule properly in your environment. Yeah. Okay, I'll take a quick pause to see if there's any questions in the Q&A before I move on to the next part and do a quick demo of the setup process.
There were a couple of questions. There was one when you very first presented the... Oh, looks like that person already got it answered. And the second one is Joule part of the CPEA entitlements, or does it require separate license? And why do we need build work zone for Joule in SuccessFactors?
Good question. So at the moment, the Joule licenses are not part of CPA agreement. You do have to go through and work with your AE to get those entitlements added to your BTP global account. And the build work zone is important to support the navigational use cases that I talked about earlier. So if I go into Joule and I say I want to create a time off. When I do that, it will give me a link to an application that I can navigate to. That navigational use cases are supported only if I do the sync from SuccessFactors into Build Work Zone. So I actually have to create a content provider in Build Work Zone, and I need to do a user sync from SuccessFactor into that content provider in Build Work Zone to support those navigational use cases. And I'll show you that in the demo later on as well.
There are a couple other. I don't know if you want to answer the two or if you want to wait till the end.
Yeah, let's wait till the end. Maybe I'll try to tackle those during the... hopefully some of those get answered as I do my demo here as well. Okay.
Yeah, perfect.
So let me go into my BTP global account here. So in BTP global account, the way you set up your Joule instance is that there is a booster here that you can execute. Okay, so and there are steps I will talk about what you need to do to get this working. So eventually you're going to be coming in here and you're going to be executing this Joule booster, right? But before we can execute this Joule booster, there are a set of things that you have to do in the BTP in the subaccount and so on, and those are all documented in the Discovery Center in terms of what you need to do, okay? So if I go and close the preparation phase and move into the setup area, the very first step that you need to do is to register your SuccessFactor environment with your BTP global account. And the way you would do that is you go into the system landscape under here. And you may have an existing system for your SuccessFactor environment that's been already registered. If that's the case, then you don't need to go through this process. But if you do not have an existing SuccessFactor system in the system landscape, what you would need to do is you would need to click on Add System, choose SuccessFactor as a system type, give it a meaningful name. I'm just going to call it Demo 2 or something like that. But normally you would want to put in your SuccessFactor company ID and give it something more descriptive so it makes sense to you when you come to this interface what that system is for. And what this will do is allow the SuccessFactor system, but then what you also need to do is to get this token, which will be shared with the SuccessFactor admin, who will then need to add that in the SuccessFactor side. And so I'm going to take this token, go into my SuccessFactor environment, if I can find it, and go into Extension Center in SuccessFactor, and add this token in this interface. And you can see that we've done this already, so I'm not going to go through this process again, but the token that I just copied from the global account would be added here, and the status would be integrated. And then if I go back to my system landscape, I should see my SuccessFactor system as registered here, just like you see in my landscape here as well. Okay. That's one of the steps that you will go through. And in fact, that's the very first step in the Discovery Center and how to register your SuccessFactor environment with the BTP global account. So if you click on this tile, it talks through or walks you through the exact same steps that I just described in a fair bit of detail with all the screenshots as well. So you can easily follow this without too much trouble. One thing that customers often struggle with is they don't have this Extension Center enabled in SuccessFactor, but if you follow the preparation steps earlier, I also explained how you can make sure that on SuccessFactor, the Extension Center is enabled for you, okay? So that's the very first card, but then before you can run the booster, you need to configure your BTP sub account. You need to have a trust set up with IAS and so on. So I have an existing global account that I can show you if I can find my system. Sorry, let me search for. And let's go into, so this is one of my sub accounts that I set up earlier. So in this sub-account, what we've done is made sure that I have the right entitlements, right? So in the entitlements for the sub-account, I should see the Joule entitlements, and I should also see the Build Work Zone entitlements, right? So if I search for Joule, I have the Joule entitlement available to me. So as a global account admin, you will also need to create a sub-account. You'll need to make sure that the Joule as well as the Build Work Zone entitlements are added to the sub-account. And once those entitlements are added, then we need to go into the trust configuration rather and ensure that we have an OpenID Connect trust with our IAS. So I think there was a question in the chat earlier about whether I can use OpenID Connect or SAML trust. So in order for Joule to work, your trust with your IAS tenant has to be OpenID Connect, which is exactly the same thing I have here as well. In addition, if you look at the domain here that I'm using, the domain that I chose is the cloud.sap domain. Okay? And this is, again, going back to the preparation steps, because I could have choose the ondemand.com domain when I set up the trust as well, but it really depends upon how your SuccessFactor system is set up and when it did the integration with cloud identity services. That would determine whether you would use a cloud.sap domain when you set up this trust or whether you would use the ondemand.com domain when you set up this trust in the BTP sub account. Okay. So my SuccessFactor tenant is using this hcm.cloud.sap domain. So it's already gone through what we call the common super domain migration on the SuccessFactor side. So if my SuccessFactor tenant is already migrated to the common super domain, then in the BTP trust, I would want to use the cloud.sap. But that's something that I mentioned in the preparation steps. Yeah. So I need this. In addition to that, when I set up my sub account, I need to make sure that I also include my SuccessFactor tenant URL in this trusted domains setting. And this is all documented in the Discovery Center mission when you set up your BTP sub account. Okay. So if I have the entitlements, if I have the trust set up, I have Cloud Foundry org and space enabled in my BTP sub account, then I can, and I've done the registration at the BTP global account level with SuccessFactor, then I can go at the global account level and run the booster that I just described. Okay, so here under the boosters, go in here and run the Joule booster. So I don't know if you have time to wait for this to finish, but it's checking for prerequisites, right? If you have the right entitlements and if you have the right authorizations and so on, and if you have identity authentication tenant and available in your global account. It's checking all of that. And then what I will ask for is, which sub-account do I want to set up my Joule instance in, essentially, right? So I am going to pick the one that I was just showing you earlier. And I have lots and lots of sub-accounts, so I'll just need to scroll down. I believe it's this one, right? And in your case, you wouldn't be using the foundation plan, but this is an internal tenant. So I'm using the standard plan for customers. When you set this up, the plan type would be just a foundation plan. Right? So here's my sub-account. It automatically populated the Cloud Foundry org and space because I created that ahead of time in the sub-account. Then I can go through the process to decide, okay, which environment am I setting this up for? Because Joule can also work with other SAP applications. You can pick more than one, but for now, we're just setting up SuccessFactors. And we can decide whether I'm setting up a production or a testing environment and go through the process. So now on this screen, it's going to ask me to pick one of those systems that I registered under the system landscape. So I need to pick the correct one, and I believe it was this one. So I had pre-registered an environment in the system landscape, and this dropdown is coming from when I did the token exchange with SuccessFactor as part of the previous step. So you'll have to have something in the system landscape that's already registered before you can select something from this screen. All right, so if everything checks out and you go through this process, you can finish and it will go through and run this wizard for you, and it will create the Joule service, and it will also do some configuration on the SuccessFactor side as well. It will add the Joule permission on the SuccessFactor side and so on. So this, and it also creates a couple destinations in the BTP sub-account as well, right? So I'm not gonna wait for this to finish. It does take a few minutes to run. So I'll go to one of my existing sub-accounts where this has already been set up. So let me duplicate this tab. And I will go into my account explorer and I'll go to one of the sub accounts that I've already set up with this interface. Okay, so once that booster is executed, what should happen is you will see under instances and subscription, you will see the Joule application get created. Okay, what you will also see are a couple destinations that get pre-created by the Joule booster. Okay. And so the destinations that the booster will create will be this runtime destination, and it will create this SFSS SSO destination, okay? But the other destination, this design time destination, this navigation service destination, this is something you will have to create manually in the environment. Okay, so if I go back to the Discovery Center mission and look at the steps, after you execute the booster, there are a few things that you need to do, okay? You need to update the configuration in Cloud Identity Services. So when the booster executes, what it does is it actually creates an application in your IaaS tenant, okay? It will create this DAS-IAS application in your IAS tenant. It would also create this document grounding application. And this document grounding application is not something you will use as part of this mission, but it offers additional capabilities in Joule that you can set up in addition to the steps that you'll go through in the mission. But for now, the most important part is that you need to look at this particular application that gets created by the booster after it's executed in IaaS, and you want to make sure that this application is using the right identity service for authentication. So some of our customers have SuccessFactors set up to integrate with cloud to a corporate IDP, whether that's Azure or whatnot. So their SuccessFactor environment in IaaS, the conditional authentication is set up to go to some sort of a corporate IDP, whether it's Okta or Microsoft Entra ID or whatnot. So what you will need to do is look at the conditional authentication setup here to see if this is using a corporate IDP, and then configure this application that's created by the booster in your IIS tenant to mimic the trust configuration or the conditional authentication setup that you have in the SuccessFactor. Okay? So if this is using, say, a Microsoft Entra ID as a default IDP, then this Joule application that gets created by the booster should also be configured to be set up the same way. Otherwise, the authentication for Joule will fail when you launch it from the SuccessFactor environment. Yeah. So these are all of the types of things that you need to check for when you're going through this mission. So I don't think I have time to go through every single step, but this dial talks about checking the configuration in IIS for your application, right? And then what we also need to do, as I mentioned before, as part of the setup process, is we need to create a build work zone instance. We need to create some destinations in BTP, and we need to create a content provider in build work zone. And it's that content provider that we then use to do the user sync from SuccessFactors into IIS. So in my landscape, I've pre-created these destinations. So you need the design time destination. You need this runtime destination that's created by the booster. You need to actually do a slight update to this runtime destination and add this SAP start property. Otherwise, this runtime destination will not actually show up in build work zone. So once you have the destinations created, we can go into instances and subscription, go to our build work zone environment. So this build work zone subscription, as well as this build work zone instance, is something you'll also have to create as part of the setup steps. And here we can go in and create a content provider. Yeah. And this content provider is going to then reference those runtime destination, the design time destinations that I was just talking about earlier. And you can see that I've created a content provider already. It has a particular ID, and these are the design time destination and the runtime destinations in the BTP subaccount that are being used for this content provider. Yeah. In order to do this properly, when you go back into my BTP environment, if I can find the right tab for it. That's not the one that I wanted to show you. Sorry, you got too many windows open. Bear with me. Yeah, right here. In order to set up create those destinations that I talked about in the work zone instance, you'll create this work zone key. So some of the destinations require the information from this key file to be able to create the destination. So in particular, that there's the design time destination here, right? Let me go back. So this navigation service destination that you create from scratch, this is going to need some information from the work zone instance. So the key file that you create will have the portal service URL, it will have the client ID, the client secret, and it will also have the token service URL that you will need to use, okay? All of that information that you need to create this particular navigation service destination comes from this key file that you create as part of the setup process. And this is, again, all documented in the Discovery Center mission on how to create the instance and how to create this key file. As for example, you will need this portal service URL for that navigation service destination. You need the client ID, you need the client secret. You also need this token service URL in the process. Okay? When you are creating the destination, make sure that when you copy this token service URL, that you add OAuth token to the end of it. Okay, that's something that you need to do as well. Let me navigate to my subaccount. So in here, if I go back to my destinations and I show you the navigation service, those fields that I was just showing you earlier are coming from that key file that I was just opening up. And here's the token service URL that you can copy from that file, but make sure you add the OAuth token at the end. If you don't do that, then those navigational use cases that I described will not work, okay? I'm going through this rather fast because there's quite a few steps and it's hard to cover all of them in a short webinar here, but let's go back to the Discovery Center mission. So as part of the process, you create a build work zone content provider, which relies on you creating some destinations in the BTP environment. So if you follow this particular link, it'll talk about how to create the design time destination from scratch, how to create that navigation service from scratch, and then use those destinations in creating the content provider. Okay. So once the content provider is created, the only other thing that we need to do is actually create a source system in our identity provisioning for user replication. So even if a customer has an existing SuccessFactors source system created to connect to SuccessFactors, we typically, during the setup process, create a new one just for Joule. And the reason why we do that is that we can actually then do some filtering and stuff like that on the usernames that we want to replicate into work zone so that we don't do a full user sync. Okay. So we add some filters in our identity provisioning service to only replicate a handful of users in the initial get-go. So we're not spending a lot of time trying to wait for that user replication process to complete. That's part of the reason why we create a new Joule instance or a new Joule source system configuration to connect to SuccessFactors. Okay. So as part of your configuration, you will be going through and creating the source system. You will also be creating a target system for build work zone, because for Joule, for those navigational use cases that I talked about, we need to replicate users from SuccessFactors into this build work zone environment that we created earlier. And so when you set this up, you will need to specify the provider ID, and the provider ID needs to match exactly what you see on the success in the content provider that I was showing you before in BTP, right? So here's my content provider. Here's the provider ID that needs to match what I specify when I create this work zone target system. Okay. So you specify the provider ID, you specify the client ID and client secret and so on, and some of these token service URLs. This is against the stuff that you will get from that key file that I was showing you before. And all of this step on how to create the source and the target systems are actually documented in the Discovery Center mission, right? So configuring identity provisioning for user application. We actually give you a link to a zip file that you can download, and it has a predefined source and a target system. You can import that into your cloud identity services, into identity provisioning, and tweak the settings. There are certain placeholders that you would have to adjust, but then you can use those rather than having to add or create those source and target systems from scratch. Okay. So it'll walk you through the process of what you need to do to actually do that configuration. Okay. So if all of this stuff is done, there's a few additional steps that you have to go through to get this working properly, right? Once the user sync is done and so on, then you go into SuccessFactors. Make sure that in SuccessFactors, users have permissions to launch Joule. And if they have permissions to launch Joule, then they can launch the Joule icon in SuccessFactors and go through and actually leverage and take advantage of using the Joule functionality. So let me see if I can do this quickly, show you what the... I'm going to open this up in a new incognito window. Right, so I'm just going back into SuccessFactors, log in as a user. And so if you do the steps that I went through very, very fast in your environment, what you should have is this Joule icon. And this Joule icon would be only visible to users if they have a Joule permission added in their SuccessFactors profile. So what the booster, when you run the booster on the BTP side, what it also does is it actually creates that specific Joule permission in SuccessFactors. So the SuccessFactors admin needs to make sure that the Joule permission is added to the user's profile, essentially. And if you have that permission added, then you can go in and launch the Joule icon. And then you can go in and ask it some kind of basic use cases for transactional as well as navigational use cases. So for example, you create time off or create vacation request or something like that. It should give me a link to an application that I can then go to see the go time. This is a time off application in SuccessFactors. If I click on it, it will take me to that time off application and I can go through this setup. So this is what we call a navigational use case, right? And in order for this navigational use case to work, I need the work zone instance set up. I need the user sync done using the identity provisioning stuff that I was just showing you earlier to be able to support this workflow. So the other use case is, I want to, let's say, view location or something like that. This is one of those use cases that's more of a transactional use case. Or if I want to, I see my information, right? I can also type in, like, say, view my manager, for example, right? These are all some of these use cases are transactional as well as navigational, right? So when I look at my manager, I'm pulling up information from my SuccessFactors environment, and it gives me my manager's information. But this link here on the right-hand side is a navigational use case, because when I click on it, it will take me to my manager's profile. So in order for this link to show up on the right-hand side when I did this query, I need to also make sure my user sync from SuccessFactors to work zone is done properly. In some cases, if you don't see these links show up next to a query that I just did, for example, viewing my manager, then that means that the user sync wasn't done properly, work zone setup wasn't done properly to support those particular navigational use cases. These are just some examples, but you can also then, there are other use cases where you can say, okay, I want to change my address or something like that. I don't know if I have that setup properly done, but in order to support this use case, you need to have the quick links enabled. And the reason why I'm getting that permission is because I haven't, or why I'm getting that error message is because I haven't enabled those quick actions or those quick links in my SuccessFactors environment. And that's part of the reason why it's giving me this error message. So again, if you go back to the preparation steps, there are steps on how to enable those quick links that you need to follow to support some of the use cases that I talked about earlier, okay? So I will pause here and I leave at least 5 minutes for Q&A here. I know it's not a lot of time, but if you go back to your Discovery Center mission, everything that I just talked about is documented. There are a few additional steps that you have to go through on the SuccessFactors side to be able to set this up properly. But the mission is very thorough. You should be able to go through this without too many issues. Just pay very special attention to the preparation steps. Pay special attention to when you're creating those destinations that I talked about and making sure you pick the right URL. So let me maybe just quickly go back to the destination step. So for example, when you're creating the navigation service, right, don't forget to add OAuth token to the end of the URL here. I highlight that in the screenshot, but customers often forget to do that. In addition, when you're creating the design time destination, you will need the SuccessFactors API URL that you will get from the preparation steps. But in addition to that, you need to add all of this to the end of the URL when you create the destination. So don't forget to do that as well. That's my only tip. That's where customers make the most mistakes in the setup process. Or they forget to, or they ignore the preparation steps, which is probably the most important part of this mission. I will pause here. Excellent. And I'll see if there's any questions.
No, thank you so much. And like you said, very, very thorough. And we really appreciate the extents of the enablement material that you've made available in the Discovery Center mission and how it's all laid out in the individual phases. It makes it very easy to understand and also easy to follow. So let's quickly take a couple of questions if we can. And then, like I said to everybody, the recording will be made available on YouTube. So if you joined late, you can view that later. So let me hop over into the chat and see where we are at with questions. The first one is, will we run into issues if we use SAML single sign-on for SuccessFactors, but OIDC single sign-on for BTP?
Nope, you will not. So SuccessFactors integration by default with IIS is SAML. We just need to make sure the sub-account where Joule will be set up is using OpenID Connect. If you have SAML trust, it will not work in the sub-account.
Thank you. And is SAP WorkZone a prerequisite for Joule?
Yes, SAP Build WorkZone Foundation is a prerequisite, as I just described. You need that set up for those navigational use cases.
Mm-hmm. Can I integrate Joule for SuccessFactors in the WorkZone Advanced Edition?
No, not at the moment. We plan to support WorkZone Advanced, but at the moment, it's only WorkZone Foundation plan and the WorkZone Standard plan that's supported.
SAP Work, oh no, so the other one I already asked, is Joule available on-premise or only cloud?
No, it's only in the cloud. All of the new innovations from SAP are in the cloud world.
The data Joule access is permissioned. What happens if a user wants to try to see other person's address? That's what you showed, right? That it'll tell you that it doesn't have permissions.
Yeah, so like if I want to change address for some other user, as long as a quick action that I set up in SuccessFactors allows me to do that, then I would be able to do it. It's all based on the permissions that you have in SuccessFactors itself. If you can do something in the SuccessFactors interface, like when you go to the if the SuccessFactors interface allows you to do that action, then Joule will also allow you to do that action as well.
Great. And the last question right up the hour here is SAP IPS Neo environment recommended to be migrated to cloud identity infrastructure before activating Joule?
Yes, it's a requirement in many cases because in IPS Neo, the build WorkZone target environment is not available by default unless you go through like a support ticket process or there's another way to enable it. It's so most customers don't have that target system in IPS Neo. So it's better to just do the migration to the new version of IPS, not just for Joule, but there's other functionality in IPS that is available that would make it a lot easier for you to set up other integrations as well. So I would recommend you do that migration regardless of whether you're going to be setting up Joule or not.
Okay. Well, I think that covers it, everybody that typed in the questions into the chat. So thank you, Harjeet. Thank you, everybody, for joining today's session. If you haven't done so already, make sure you register for TechEd, October 8th and 9th. It's coming right up. And for any additional questions, you can reach out directly to me. And also stay tuned for our October episode that should come towards the end of the month. So thank you so much and enjoy the rest of your day wherever you are.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Bye.